say that I have curly hair.
I know.
And I didn't know that it was controversial.
Well, it's only controversial if you're a newspaper columnist.
Oh, okay.
If you're a world-renowned author, it's okay. Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Judy, for being here.
Thank you for having me here, and thank you for the warm welcome.
How do we sound? Can everyone hear us okay? Good. Okay. Good.
We can sing.
Yeah. I can't sing.
Oh, no, neither can I.
Okay, so we're here mostly to talk about your new book, and when we turn it over to questions, of course, they can be about absolutely anything. But we're going to start with In the Unlikely Event, which is based on real events. When you were in eighth grade in your hometown of Elizabeth, New Jersey, three planes crashed, right? The winter of 1951 to 1952. But you had...
In 58 days. But that's not what the book's about.
Three crashes in 58 days.
Yes.
Yeah. And you had largely buried those memories.
Apparently so, because I've been told that I've been writing books and publishing books for 46 years or something like that, and here is this great story, and how come I never thought to write about it? It makes absolutely no sense to me to have a story like that inside you. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd die to write that, and I never thought of it.
And what made you recall the events just recently?
2009, January 2009, at the literary seminar in Key West, on stage was a young writer. Our topic that year was young voices, new voices, and she's since become quite famous, Rachel Kushner. And she was talking about where she got the inspiration for her first novel, Telex from Cuba, and how it was from her stories that her mother told her about having grown up in Cuba in the 50s. I didn't hear anything Cuba growing up, and I heard the 50s. Hmm. And suddenly it was like I was hit by a ton of bricks. Mm-hmm. I mean, really, just like that. The 50s, I have an amazing story. I have to tell this story. Mm-hmm. And it came to me in a flash all at once. This has never happened to me before. It will never happen again, I know. But it came with characters, with three families, with the way that they would all be intertwined. Mm. Of course, you know, I have my own memories of that winter. Mm-hmm. But that was over the weekend, and on Monday morning, I started my research.
Wow.
And for 4 or 5 months, I can't even remember, I did nothing but research, which I loved more than anything I've ever done when it comes to writing a book, and I was so jealous of all my nonfiction writing friends, including my husband, which I always need to know where he is in the audience because I need to sometimes ask him questions. I see him. Thank you. Okay. There are sometimes things I can't think of, and I'll say, George, what is that word? What's the name of that camera, speed graphic camera? So I need to know where he is.
And is it true that he bought you a microfilm machine to
he
do
did.
Research at home?
Well, first I was at the Monroe County Public Library in Key West, and I was trying to read, because none of these, the two main newspapers are now defunct, and they're not
the
digitized. They weren't digitized.
Newspaper and the...
And so I had to read them, and that's where the machines were, in the history room, and the very nice man who takes care of the history room apologized always for the dust, and it was so bad, and I'm so allergic. I was wearing little surgical masks to work every day, and then one day he said, Judy, I'm now going to open this closet, and you better, I don't know, cover yourself up with a sheet or something. And after he opened that closet and the dust came out, I couldn't do it anymore, and George said, I'm going to find you an old microfiche machine on eBay, and he did.
Mm, that's wonderful.
But better than that, eventually, I don't know if we're supposed to tell this, but eventually we were able to get all of the stories from one of the newspapers digitized.
Okay.
And that was a huge help.
In the book, you have excerpts. Are those real, or did you rewrite them based on your research?
I'm so glad you asked that question, because I like my readers to know what is real. So I was planning to use all the real newspaper stories mm-hmm. as they were in the wonderful descriptive language of the 50s.
There's that bit about the cream puff.
Oh,
so evocative.
The plane came down and broke apart like a swollen cream puff, mm-hmm. or it came down like a wounded, angry bird. I mean, it's so great, and you don't find that today. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we didn't have television news coverage.
Mm-hmm.
We had TV, but mm-hmm. there was no news coverage.
Yeah.
So you needed the reporters to paint these pictures
sure.
for you, not that With I read language. The papers at 14. Mm-hmm. I wish I could tell you I did, but I don't think I did. But anyway, I was planning to use the stories to help tell my story, mm-hmm. Which is the story of the three fictional families.
Right.
But everything about the planes, everybody on the planes, all of that was based on real people, real mm-hmm. stories from the newspaper. But these newspaper stories came with bylines. And I just felt like these newspaper men, as they like to be called, were my best friends.
Mm-hmm.
I knew them so well. And then one day last fall, very close to the deadline that I was working on to get the rest of the book done, I was told at Knopf, you really can't use these stories with the bylines and then give the byline to your fictional character, Henry Ammerman,
mm-hmm.
who is the young reporter who makes his name covering these stories. And so, like, what was I going to do? I said, there's no way. They said, you have to mix and match. You have to make composite stories.
Oh, okay.
You can use the language. And I said, there's no time. I can't do it.
Yeah.
At which point, my Henry Ammerman, George Cooper, my husband, stood up and said, I can be your Henry. I know this is an awe moment, because he's a wonderful writer and a nonfiction writer, and we turned our little living room, we live in Key West, but we have a little apartment in New York, and we turned it into a newsroom. And it was like, of course, I was the city editor, and I would give him his assignments, and he would bring them back, and good thing that he's very, easygoing, and he knows that he's a good writer, and I would read the story, and I would say, I would make MB, which somebody once did to me a long time ago, which
MB.
I hated, MB, make better.
Oh.
She did that to me. I've
That's
never
big.
Forgiven her or forgotten it, but George and I joke about the MB all the time, and then he'd bring it back, and it was always so much better, and so we have wonderful stories that now actually help me tell the story mm-hmm. in a way that makes more sense. And so I'm very thankful to my Henry Ammerman.
In addition to the hours upon hours of research that went into the book, there's all these lovely details that couldn't come from anyone other than someone who lived in the era, which is another thing I love about the book. I have to read this one aloud. This is just an example. The fathers took turns driving their daughters to and from events, a get-together in someone's finished basement, a dance at the Y, a Saturday night movie. Mothers might drive them somewhere during the day, but at night it was strictly fathers.
Yeah, I didn't research that.
That's what I mean.
But of course, Miri, who is the main voice, mm-hmm. I guess. I've read that in enough reviews so that I now believe that Miri starts the book. It's not a spoiler to say that the book begins in 1987 when there is a 35th reunion of the worst year of her life, and she is coming back for it. She's now 50 years old, and then we quickly go back to Miri at 15, mm-hmm. the winter of 51-52, and we end again with a much longer stretch of Miri at 50. So I guess she is the main voice. There are mm-hmm. many, many voices, and here you're getting it straight from the author's mouth here. When you start and there are a lot of characters and a lot of voices up front, don't worry about keeping them straight. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about it, because you will come to see that they're all connected.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Did you have trouble keeping them straight?
At first I did, to be honest. But yeah. By about, I wouldn't even say halfway through, probably a quarter of the way through, I thought, okay, I don't have to keep flipping back and going, Phil
no,
Stein.
No, don't bother doing that.
Because it just, yeah, it does all come together
it
very
comes
neatly.
Together.
Yeah.
It shouldn't take you that long.
Well, maybe I'm slow.
I told my editor, I said, you know, Carol, maybe we should do one of those things that the Russian novels do.
Uh-huh.
You know, as the families here
right.
and the friends here, and then everyone will know. I might still do that on a blog. And Carol said, are you crazy? You know, trust your readers. Mm-hmm. They will get it.
Yeah, so, and they'll hang with a story because it's such a fascinating story.
So don't bother, you know, worrying about who's related to who. You get a lot of families up front, and then you stay with them, and they come together.
They do. Well,
a young reader.
A young reader. One of the themes throughout the book is consistent, I think, with all of your writing, which is this desire on the part of young people to be dealt with honestly by adults, and this feeling that adults are sort of holding back larger truths from them. And I noticed it throughout this book and in your other books too. That's a theme that you hit repeatedly.
I'm not aware of it when I'm doing it, but now I'm thinking that it was true for me. It was true for my generation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, adults kept secrets mm-hmm. from kids. I think, sure, they still do. But no one, just to give you an idea, no adult parents or teachers at school ever talked to us about what was going on in our community. Mm-hmm. I mean, this was, you know, a whole community was involved in this. A whole community had no idea what was going on. There was no explanation for this.
Yeah.
So, because nobody was talking to us, you know, the kids, well, we made up our own ideas of what
sure.
was going on. The boys,
UFOs and
the junior high boys, you know, they were into flying saucers and creatures from outer space and zombies that were making these planes
mm-hmm.
come down. And of course, communists, that was a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the smart girls in my class, I was in eighth grade, but Miri's in ninth grade, the smart girls in talk about sabotage.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to be one of the smart girls, and so I agreed that, of course, it's sabotage.
Of course.
And then I went to the dictionary to look up sabotage. But we didn't know who. And you know, the adults, none of us knew. Nobody
mm-hmm.
knew really what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And Henry Emmerman is covering these stories. It makes so little sense, even now, when I went back to Elizabeth
mm-hmm.
with reporters recently and
mm-hmm.
TV people to show them the sites. And I'm thinking to myself, this is crazy.
It's crazy.
It's never happened anywhere else. It will never happen
mm-hmm.
anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
It's never happened again.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you should know that Elizabeth, New Jersey is like this close to Newark Airport. And we're talking about the 50s, and you know, commercial flying around was new.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you didn't just do it the way we do it now.
Mm-hmm.
17 planes on my book tour right now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm counting them off. I'm not afraid to fly. In fact, something really interesting has happened. Since I wrote this book, I don't know why, whether I've worked something through, but I can sleep on planes now.
Huh.
I just go right to sleep like George always has done. I can go right to sleep. I'm not listening for all the sounds
mm-hmm.
to fly the plane the way I used to.
Huh.
I'm much more relaxed, and I do believe that I've worked it through in some way.
Hmm. That's interesting.
My daughter, of course, my daughter became a commercial airline pilot. And when she read an early draft of this book, She said to me, "Mother, I can't believe you never told me this story. I never told anybody this story."
Yeah.
Which is so unlike me. I tell everybody anything.
Right.
Everything. But I never told her. I never told George this story.
Wow. And was it in part an attempt to, or an avoidance of stories about the 50s? Because I've read you have said in the past, it's an era you weren't interested in writing about. Were you avoiding it for that? Although that wouldn't explain why you wouldn't talk to your family about it, I guess.
I did think that the 50s were, when I was living through the 50s, mm-hmm. and I love what you said about, you know, because some people think that I did a tremendous amount of research on
the 50s.
Growing up in the 50s, mm-hmm. like how did I know to put Angora sweaters in the refrigerator?
Right.
Because I was there, you know? I knew who I was dancing with at the Y when mm-hmm. Nat King Cole was singing Unforgettable. I have a great memory for all these mm-hmm. things, but much less of a great memory for this,
this event,
these tragedies.
Mm-hmm. Did you journal as a young girl, as a child?
We didn't call it journaling. I had a diary.
Your diary.
You know, I had a diary. I didn't really do a lot of it. I mean, I did it when I was 17. That was the diary that I kept. It was like one of those insurance books that you got every year in the mail. My father mm-hmm. was a dentist, and he got the little books from the insurance company and brought home to me. And it was so boring when I read it. It was only about boys.
Yeah.
Only about boys, and it was all done with certain code words and rubber bands so that if my mother read it, like, she wouldn't understand these code words and what they meant. And I would know because the rubber bands would be put on in a different
way. In a certain
way.
Oh. Yeah. Well, that blows.
And she did.
She read them?
Well, the rubber bands were in different places. Oh. But she never talked to me about it.
Oh.
Never talked to me about anything.
That shoots a hole in my theory, which was that your journals are why you're so good at channeling young kids in your writing, but it's not from going back and reading your own journals.
No.
How are you so good at it then? What do you do? It's a gift.
I have this memory. That's my gift. I mean,
of being a child.
You know, yes, of everything, mm-hmm. mostly.
Empathy,
when
too,
kids
though.
Ask me now, kids ask me, "What's your superpower?" Everybody is supposed mm-hmm. to have a superpower. And it's like, okay, what's my superpower?
What's your superpower?
Maybe I should say it's memory. Yeah. I say it's, you know, flying, but it's not flying high in the sky. It's hovering. And it's not flying horizontally. It's flying, whatever you call this, up and down. And
mm-hmm.
I can
vertically.
Hear everything that everyone is saying because I was always very curious, and I always wanted to know what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
Can I just say one thing about my father being a dentist, and
Absolutely.
Then I promise to let you ask me a question.
Everyone's here to hear you talk, so you talk as much as you want.
The only character in the book, in the fictional part of the book, is a dentist called Dr. O, and my father was a dentist, mm-hmm. a much beloved dentist, and I adored him. And I knew that he was going at night to the morgue to identify victims by dental records. Somehow I knew that. Mm. I knew the dentists in town were all called in to help do this. Mm. It was never talked about mm-hmm. at home, but I knew it. And so I knew that, Dr. O would be doing that.
Mm-hmm. Is Miri in some ways you as a child?
I don't think so. I don't think so. It's that one. No. everyone thinks that because Miri is the kind of major protagonist,
mm-hmm.
but I don't think so. I mean, I'm in a lot of my other books,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not Miri. I like Miri,
mm-hmm.
but Miri isn't really me.
Mm-hmm.
Family situation entirely different.
Right.
And I'm certainly not Natalie,
no.
who's cuckoo. Mm-hmm. I mean, she's fine. She's going to be fine. I was a drama queen. My aunt used to call me Camille, as in, you know, Camille. What is Camille in? Help.
Laying on her deathbed.
Camille, mm-hmm. Right? Very dramatic. Yes, my aunt used to call me Camille.
Well, we learn how all the characters fare because you do end it in 1987, you mentioned earlier. So tell me about the decision to do that.
Okay, but no spoilers.
Okay, I won't say what happened to anyone, you do look ahead at the end.
I do look ahead. I really wanted to know myself where these characters would be mm-hmm. 35 years later. And, you know, for all of the women who have written to me asking for a book about Margaret in menopause. Uh-huh. And I say, I'm awfully sorry, but Margaret's always going to be 12. Mm-hmm. Mary at 50 has hot flashes.
Uh-huh. We're going to turn it over to questions in just a couple of minutes, but I want to read this one quote from the book I'm sure you've seen, Everything I Needed to Know About Being a Girl I Learned from Judy Blume.
Yeah, I wasn't happy about that book. So
really?
No, I wasn't.
Oh, why not?
I don't know. I just nobody asked me about it. Nobody told me about it. It was published by one of my publishers, and nobody ever mentioned it to me. And so, even Meg Cabot said to me, she said, I wrote a piece because I assumed you wanted
you
me to
it,
and were
yeah.
friends.
Yeah.
You know, she said, I did it for you. I didn't know you didn't know anything about the book.
Wow.
But it's okay. It's all right. It's fine.
What if they had approached you and asked? Or even given you a heads up, would you have liked the idea or would you have hated it?
I probably wouldn't have liked it.
Yeah.
But it's okay.
Okay.
I get over things quickly. I heat up quickly and then I get over it quickly.
Okay, well, origins
of
the quote aside.
You can read it if you want to.
I do love this quote from the novelist Stephanie Lessing. And she said, Judy Blume was the first woman to look girls straight in the eye and tell it the way it is. No one had ever thought to tell us that all that strangeness going on in our bodies wasn't strange at all. And no one ever talked to us about other girls. It's amazing that we ever got along without her.
Oh, that's sweet. Thank you.
So how does that...
But no gushing.
I'm not gushing.
No gushing tonight. No
I'm an objective journalist.
Okay, good.
Right down the middle. How does that feel to have people say that about you? You said you get 1,000 emails a month still. I mean, do you feel monumental?
Oh, yeah. You know, it feels great, and I am grateful to my readers because without them, I would have nothing. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, it's dangerous to think of this when you write, especially. You know, I think it would be paralyzing to go into that little room and think, I'm so great. I know what I'm doing. Because it's always more like, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't have a clue how to do this. And I just have to... believe that it will come the way it's always come, mm-hmm. and I don't know how it comes, and I don't really understand where it comes from, and I think to try to analyze it and figure it out would be to kill it, and so I don't spend a lot of time on that, and mm-hmm. you know, I'm grounded. I have a family. Mm-hmm. I have a husband who says, enough of this goddess stuff. When do I get you back? He's very sweet. I told him he's allowed to sleep through all of these things since he's traveling.
I think I was supposed to announce that the index cards will be collected now. Is someone out there collecting? I'm having a hard time seeing what's happening out there. That's nice.
Oh, look, index cards.
Okay. So we're going to collect those right now, and then I have one final question about your process. So you said earlier this is the first time that the families and the stories have just come to you. How else does it work?
Well, I have to say that, I mean, the best part of writing are the surprises along the way, for me anyway. Not to know, but to be surprised. Oh, I like this. I can see you now.
This is nice.
And certainly that was true in this book, too. But it came with structure and plot, something that, you know, I'm not big on plot. But it came that way. And I think, you know, I stayed pretty much true to the way it came. Although the characters, although they came at that moment, they weren't fully realized. And there's something in the book that I just adore that came, I'm sorry to say that I adore something about my own book, that's embarrassing. It came so late in the process and unexpectedly. And it's a little scene very toward the end with Miri as a grown woman sitting on a plane next to a little girl named Lily. And I don't know where that came from or why that came, but that has become one of my favorite moments in the book. And a friend of mine had been to Portugal. I know where that came from. And she said, she wrote me a little message and she said, have you been to Portugal? It's wonderful. Everything is tiled, including the toothbrushes. And so in this, Lily's father is a pilot and she's just come from Portugal. And she says to Miri, have you been? And Miri says, no, Miri's now 50. And she said, well, you should go. Do you like tile? And she says, yes, of course. And she said, well, everything is tiled, including your toothbrush. And I just love it. And it's the moment where the flight attendant stands up and says, in the unlikely event, which they don't do anymore, by the way. And Lily says, I don't like that part of flying. And Miri says to Lily, there are many unlikely events in life, and some of them are very good, like the two of us meeting. Makes me cry. And so, you know, it's not a downer of a book, although there is a background of tragedy. It's how people change and behave and decide what to do with their lives when something like this happens close to them, and it makes some of them react in one way and others react in another way. But ultimately, it is what my father used to say to me, is that life goes on. And it may not go on in the same way, but life goes on. And people fall in love, and people go to school, and they go to work, and life goes on.
I think that's a nice place to transition into questions from the audience. Looks like we have an ample supply.
I like questions.
This question is from Alyssa in fifth grade. What is your favorite book series?
Does she mean... not that I wrote, that I wrote.
Well, let's...
Alyssa, where
both?
Are you, Alyssa? Alyssa? Are you there? Are you there, Alyssa? It's me, Judy.
Oh, she's... see her.
Do you see Alyssa?
Alyssa, do you mean that Judy wrote or that someone else wrote? That Judy wrote. Your favorite book that you wrote.
Oh, okay. Or, well, that I can't answer, because that, after all of that, that's like asking a mom, you know, who's your favorite child? And so they're all special in some way. You know, Margaret brought me my first readers, and Fudge brought me my first readers, and so they're very special. Mm-hmm. But there are others that I like, too. The favorite series that I read when I was growing up was a series, maybe some of you know it, by Maud Hart Lovelace, the Betsy Tacy books. And they are wonderful books, and they have been reissued, new editions, and I read them again, scared to death that they wouldn't hold up, And I spent a whole weekend locked up in my study reading them from, they go from age 5 through Betsy's marriage. Mm. And I came out just gushing tears because they were still so wonderful. Mm. I loved those books.
Did you read the Anne of Green Gables books?
I didn't. Everyone asked me that. I'm sorry. I could lie, but then you might ask me a question about them. I didn't read Anne of Green Gables.
That's okay. You still could.
It's never too late.
Yeah, it's never too late.
It's never too late.
Why did you choose to write a novel for adults this time? Of course, not your first adult novel.
No, it's my fourth. Well, you know, there was a lot of questions. I mean, really, I don't like categories. I don't like labeling books. I was reading in my parents' bookshelves their books when I was 12 and 13. There were no YA books. And mm-hmm. so I went from kids' books right into their books. And they gave me the wonderful gift of reading is a great thing. We're proud of you. You know, we're not afraid of what you're reading.
Mm-hmm.
We're glad you're reading. They took me to movies. Movies weren't rated. They took me to the theater. Sometimes my mother would say to me, did you understand that movie? And I would say, yes, but I didn't have a clue.
Uh-huh.
But so what? So I got what I got out of it, just like I got whatever I got out of reading Saul Bellow when I was 13. It was part of that that secret life of adults that I was so curious mm-hmm. about. So I don't like labels, mm-hmm. but unfortunately in today's world, your book is published by either the adult mm-hmm. section or the young adult or the, you know, children's,
right. mm-hmm.
and then it's bought by those book buyers in bookstores, and so you have to put some label on it. It's fine with me. If teenagers feel that they want to read this book,
sure.
great, mm-hmm. read it. You have my permission.
Yeah, the protagonist, as you okay. mentioned, is 14.
There are a lot of protagonists in the book who are young, 15, mm-hmm. 18, 17. Some of it could be disturbing, but I always find that if it's disturbing, you put it down. If mm-hmm. I'm reading a scary book before I go to sleep at night, mm-mm. Hmm. I put it down.
Yeah.
I won't do that.
Yeah.
So this is an adult book because I wanted to work with an editor, Carol Barron, who worked with me on Summer Sisters. And we work well together. And she happens to publish adult books. And really, I wanted to go into the adults' heads in this book. I wanted to know Miri's beautiful single mother, Rusty.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to know what was in Rusty's head. And her wonderful grandma, Irene. Mm-hmm. I wanted to go into Irene's head and into Henry Ammerman and into, you know, the adult characters yeah. as well.
Mm-hmm. How connected do you feel to newer young adult authors who struggle with content objections, challenges, and outright bans of their work? This is signed an English teacher. And of course, you've experienced being banned.
As what? Assigned by an English teacher?
I'm sorry, it's signed by
an English teacher wrote
the question.
Oh, I have many young friends, I'm so proud of them, who write YA books, and I stand behind them when their books are challenged. Right now, Sherman Alexie's book, fabulous, fabulous book, the real life true story, I don't know what it is, of a something something mm-hmm. Indian. It's a great book. I gave it to my 50-year-old son, who was once Fudge, to read when he was visiting. And he said, this is one of the best books I've ever read. It's published YA. It is a great book. And bear in mind that those who want to censor, ban, challenge books, they don't come after books that kids don't like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't even know about those books
right.
or care about those books.
Mm-hmm.
It's when kids begin to like something that they say, aha, there must be something wrong here.
Mm-hmm.
There must be something bad for kids if they like it. It's got to be bad.
Right.
So I work with the National Coalition Against Censorship
mm-hmm.
to help. I worked with Judy Krug here on the ALA Freedom to Read. It's Michelle, are you here? Hi. She knows I loved her mom. And her mom was the best spokesperson fighting censorship ever. And she could have talked on my behalf anytime. She was wonderful.
What was your first experience with censorship of one of your books? What was the first time?
Well, really, it all started in 1980. And remember, I wrote all those books that some of you grew up reading in the 70s. Mm-hmm. 70s was a very free, open time, a very good time for young readers and writers. And, you know, publishers were willing to take chances on us. I was found in the slush pile. Mm-hmm. And but I got a phone call after Margaret was published. This was my first experience with anything like this. And this woman called me at home, and she asked if I had written the book, and I was very excited. And I said, yes. And she called me a communist and hung up. Wow. You know, not even in the 50s, in this, in 1970.
Free Twitter, though. It would have been
right?
much uglier.
And
Twitter
I never knew. Right. Communists. is equated with, I don't know, with menstruation.
Bras, I think.
Or puberty, or God.
Yeah. How much of the work you've submitted to publishers has been rejected?
Well, in the beginning, everything. And that's okay, I think. It wasn't, you know, I was writing some really awful stuff. I didn't know what I was doing. I was making up rhyming picture books after I put the, I had little kids then, after I put them to sleep at night. I was in my 20s and reading them a lot of Dr. Seuss books. And my maiden name was Sussman, and I thought I could be the next doctor.
Oh.
And, you know, and I fastened them together with brass fasteners, and I illustrated them myself. I can't illustrate. With colored pencils, just so you know. I have them. I've kept them all, and they're in a box in my closet.
Really?
With a note to my children that says, if you ever publish these after my death, I will come back and haunt you. So I would say, you know, for 2 years, once I started writing, I realized what I liked to read was mm-hmm. novels, and so I started writing Iggy's House chapter by chapter, week by week. I was taking a course at NYU. I had gone to NYU, and it was, you know, nobody can teach you to write, but to have support, that's the big thing. Mm-hmm. To have somebody say to you, you can do this, mm-hmm. and then to find the determination so that when it is rejected, when your work is rejected,
you say, okay,
but wait till they see the next one, and you have the determination to go on. And I tell people who want to write that that's as important as mm-hmm. you know, whatever talent you're given.
Yeah. Well, the next question actually is, what advice would you give to someone who wants to be a writer?
Well, first of all, you read. I mean, you read, 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 read. I came home with armloads of books from the public library when I decided I really wanted to write for kids. And my decision to write for kids was because, you know, the kid inside me was right there. Yeah. I mean, I remembered everything, and I identified with kids. And so I came home with all these books, and I put them into piles. These bore me. These are wonderful. Beverly Cleary, this woman makes me fall off the sofa laughing. Oh, I want to be like her. Uh-huh. You know, I was inspired by some of those books.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it's all about.
Read.
And then you eventually find your own voice.
Mm-hmm.
And you just keep going. You just keep doing it.
Are you planning to adapt more of your books for the stage? Parenthetical, I hope so. And this is signed Leslie, Children's Theater Director.
Oh, Children's Theater. We've had some great, where are you, Leslie? We've had some great children's theater, I think, made from my books. But I'm very tough, and I don't let them go easily. I love Sheila the Great. I think that's my favorite. It's a musical, mm-hmm. and I have a real soft spot for musicals. Somebody asked me the other day about my bucket list, what's left, and I'm like, what's left? And I said, a musical theater. I'd love to do a musical based on Sally Friedman. I would just love that.
This person,
and I want a player too.
This person wants to know, are you already thinking of your next novel?
Am I already thinking of my next novel? Mm-hmm. No.
No.
No, no, no. Mm-mm. 5 years on this book, mm-hmm. and it's finally finished, and I'm out here presenting it to the world, and I'm so happy to be done with it. You have no idea. And I'm never going, really, I'm never going to do another five-year intense project like this. Mm-hmm. I'm 77. I just don't want to do that. There are things I do want to do. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of creative energy left. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it'll be. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, I don't know. Maybe I'll get hit over the head again with another load of bricks mm-hmm. or potatoes or something. I don't know.
Did you say after Summer Sisters that you didn't want to write another novel?
I said after Summer Sisters, I am never, ever doing this again. Yes. And I even asked my husband. It was so long and painful. And that one was only 3 years. But that was a very painful experience. And I said to George, I never want to do this again. George said, okay, fine. I said, just promise me one thing. I mean, this is embarrassing to say, but it's true. That if I don't ever do this again, I won't wind up a bag lady. Mm-hmm. And he said, you won't. You're okay. And it'll be okay. You don't have to do it again if you don't want to. And it was like, phew. And then, of course, I wrote another Fudge book, and I wrote the Four Pain and the Great One chapter books. Mm-hmm. And I'm wasted a lot of time on screenplays. But we did get to make Tiger Eyes, mm-hmm. Which we brought to Chicago a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
That got in the way of In the Unlikely Event. It really might have taken 3 years, but the movie took two.
Okay. Now.
But I did say it. And George says, I say it after every book. Uh-huh.
So what's painful about it?
What was painful about Summer Sisters?
About the novel writing process.
Each one is different. Painful in its own way. Mm-hmm. Summer Sisters, after all my years of writing and success, was rejected by many of my longtime publishers. Hmm. And it's possible, you know, it became my most successful novel, so I can say this, ha ha ha. but it's possible that I didn't know who my audience was, mm. And that they really didn't know what to do with it. Mm-hmm. And then Carol Baron came along and said, I know what to do with this book, and I know how to help you make it work. And she did. Mm-hmm. And she was brilliant at publishing it, and, you know, it's the book that everybody writes to me about today.
It is.
This one was painful in a different way. I mean, just, I think, much more exciting for me to write. I really loved writing about it. Mm-hmm. I was stuck a bit in the beginning because then I stopped for 2 years. That's a terrible thing to do when you're writing a book. And then when I came back to it, I just did the first draft of parts 2 and 3 and 4 and realized they were so much better than what I had done in part 1, and I didn't know how to get part 1 mm-hmm. there. And Carol really helped me with that.
Interesting. This is a variation on the earlier question, but we'll see if you have a different answer. What's your favorite character you've written about? Not your favorite book. Can you pick a favorite character?
Well, the characters are the books. You know, what are the books but the characters? I always know when I read a book, if the characters stay with me, it means I really liked that book. It meant something special to me. It doesn't matter if I remember the plot. It's the characters. Mm-hmm. And so I feel the same way about my own characters. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think you already know that.
Yeah. Do you read reviews of your work?
Me?
Do you read the reviews?
Me? Yes, I read every review.
Yes.
I'd love to tell you that I don't and that I don't care, but I do. And I have to say, I'm not used to getting great reviews, and I'm absolutely stunned by the reviews for this book. And I'm trying to figure out, but I don't really want to know, is it because I'm 77 and they think that, well, she's not going to write another one, so let's be really nice to her now.
I don't think so.
Or do they really care about the book? And I hope so. It's been really wonderful.
Yeah. So do you bring the negative reviews with you to the computer when you're writing? I mean, not physically, but do they knock around in
your head?
Now,
here's a little advice for anybody who's going into that room trying to write something. You've got to kick the critic off this shoulder and kick the censor off that shoulder. If you listen to the critic whispering in your ear, you don't know what you're doing. You can't do it as well as the other people. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is, again, that's dangerous. And so you've got to kick them all out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
And negative reviews, I mean, I don't know. When I was young, I used to take a red pencil, and I would write very bad words all over the negative reviews. And in those days, I kept them in a little scrapbook. I had a little scrapbook of my reviews, you know, it was a very long time ago, and that was very satisfying.
The swear words, to write the swear words.
And I got a lot of negative reviews, a lot of them, and I expect I still will.
Yeah.
Not everybody is going to feel the same way about your book. No one book is right for every reader.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I once got a terrible review for Sally Friedman, from somebody who had given me wonderful reviews before, and I once met her, and I said, what was it?
Yeah.
What was it? And she said, when I read about the roach in the chow mein, I lost my lunch. Well, you know.
That's good writing.
Remember that. She didn't write that. That's
no,
what
I'm
she told me.
That means you painted a vivid picture.
You have to remember, even when you're reading reviews, you know, it's one person. And, well, the good ones, of course, it's different. But the bad ones.
Well, this is the same question. Have you struggled with your self-critic? How do you know when a story is done?
I do. I know when it's done. I know when it's time to send it out to an editor. I count very much on editorial input.
Feedback. Mm-hmm.
I don't see how anybody can do it without a wonderful editor.
Mm-hmm.
I have had some of the best editors from the beginning on. And I depend on that back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. And I know, I mean, with this book last year, George and I think he's sleeping. We were on our way to the UK. We were going to a book festival, the Hay Festival. And I had come to a point where I said, it's either press click and send it to Carol or burn it. And George, who is a very sensible person, said, why don't you press click? You can always burn it later. And I knew that it was time. I knew I needed her input. We had talked about this book for 5 years while I was writing it, and I had never shown her one word.
Wow.
I wouldn't show her anything.
Yeah. The ending of Summer Sisters has haunted me for many years, and I've got to ask, this person tweeted to me earlier. I think this is, I'm glad we're getting this. What happened to Kate? Do you know, or are you in the dark too?
To Caitlin. I got a tweet today from somebody who said, if you tell me what happened to Caitlin, I'll buy your new book.
Wow. Quid pro quo.
You know, I'm in Vix's head in Summer Sisters. I'm never inside Caitlin's head. We never hear any of that story from Caitlin. So what happens to Caitlin at the end? She could be in Morocco. I don't know where she is. I don't know. She might be living. She might not. I think it's for everybody who reads it to decide themselves, but that's why I didn't do it to you this time. I tell you where they are. 35 years later, you don't have to write and ask me where they are. But I wanted to do that. Mm-hmm. And with Caitlin, I never wanted to do it.
And I think you should still buy her book. It's worth reading. This sounds trite. I'm not editorializing. They wrote, this sounds trite. How do you keep your figure while writing? I love to nibble when I read and write.
I don't nibble.
You know.
I don't snack. I never have. I eat well 3 times a day. I like to go for a 2-mile walk every morning. I work out at the gym 2 times a week. I find that when you're stuck, especially in your writing, physical exercise, the act of doing something physical, just like
unlocks
I used to
it.
Bounce the ball mm-hmm. against the side of the house when I was a kid with the stories running around, it's the same thing now. Hmm. If I can't solve something, I'll walk away. I don't believe in writer's block for me. I don't believe in it. Mm-hmm. You know, there are good days and not good days. And if it's not working, I'll walk away from it. And I'll go and I'll do something physical. And it will, maybe it'll be the next day. Maybe it'll just be taking a shower. I've gotten whole books in the shower. I am so clean. You can't imagine. Long showers, shampoos, wonderful ideas, mm-hmm. you know, but doing something without the computer and without the pencil in your hand, just get away from it and let your mind wander. Mm-hmm. Isn't that a good way to end this?
Well, we have time
Do you
for
have something?
One more question.
Good. Okay.
Yeah, one more question, and I like this one. I liked them all. I like this one especially. Are you ever afraid to be honest in your writing?
I hope not. I hope not. I mean, it may be my own honesty. You know, mm-hmm. it's not everybody's honesty, but...
Is it scary to be honest?
No, not when I'm writing. No. I don't think about it. I mean, I did always... want to write very honest books for kids because I didn't have them myself when mm-hmm. I was a kid, mm-hmm. you know, and so I wanted to be honest, but I don't think about any of that when I'm writing, you know, I just don't. Somebody asked me the other night, is it embarrassing when you write about sex? And I said, well, no, because I'm in that little room all by myself. Why would I be embarrassed? And I say, I know if it's a good sex scene if I turn myself on. For me, again, only for me.
That is a good place to end.